Infertility is present in approximately 15% of the reproductive population. 3 to 5% of these are attributed to the uterine causes such as hypoplasia, agenesis, or dysfunction. In these cases, options such as surrogacy or adoption remain, which may be restricted or even prohibited in countries such as Sweden and Japan. In such cases, uterine transplant remains a feasible option. An important aspect about uterine transplant is that it is an ephemeral transplant, that is, it can last for a shorter time. That means graft can be removed after one or two successful childbirths. The basis of this paper arises from the famous paper by Bord et al., which was published in 1967 about a successful pregnancy in a kidney transplant recipient who was administered with azathioprine and prednisolone, after which more than 15,000 babies have been born to transplanted and immunosuppressed mother with no reported increase in the risk of fetal malformations. This indicated that human uterine transplantation with immunosuppression was compatible with normal pregnancy and progeny. About the first clinical uterine transplant trial, Rancho and Branstam et al., they initially put a scientific step-by-step approach. For around 10 years, they conducted scientific research, which was first time published in 2002. Initially, all the researches were conducted in animals, but in 2012, after an ethical permission was granted to the research group, it was then started first time in the human beings at Sahlgrenska University Hospital, Sweden, and the uteri were procured from the living donors. This culminated in the current trial under discussion, which was published in May 2014 in the Journal of Fertility and Sterility, published by the American Society of Reproductive Medicine. The aim and objective of this trial was to report perioperative and 6 months postoperative outcomes of the 9 donor and recipient pairs which were participating in the first uterine transplant trial. After an initial preliminary screening of 30 prospective recipients ended in a selection of 10 suitable women. This included absolute uterine factor infertility women who had Mayer-Rockitansky-Kusterhauser syndrome, in whom the sterility factor was ruled out by in vitro fertilization as well as cryopreservation, those who were fully consenting and aware about the nature of the trial and their implications, including the options of surrogacy and adoption, patients who had undergone radical hysterectomy for cervical cancer were also included in the trial. The patient should be in a steady relationship with their partners for at least 3 years, and for donors, the menopausal status was not considered. Any comorbidity or psychological risk factors in recipient or donors were excluded. These are some of the preoperative medical investigations, which included an array of clinico-radiological investigations, specifically microbiological investigations like cytomegalovirus and Epstein-Barr virus, along with HIV and HBsAg were also included. There was an interplay of multidisciplinary team of gynecology, transplantation surgery, psychology, as well as clinical immunology also. The subject's characteristics included the patients who ranged from approximately age of 27 to up to 38 years old females who were suffering from these disorders. The donors and recipients were typed for HLA typing, HLA A, B, C, DR, B1, and DQB1 by PCR technique. Anesthesia was similar in both donors and recipients. Antibiotic prophylaxis was given with piperacillin tazobactam. In the surgical part of the donor surgery, initial midline incision was taken from pubic symphysis to the umbilicus. The uterus was isolated along with long vascular pedicles, which consisted of bilateral uterine arteries and veins up to and including the parts of the internal iliac vessels. Parts of round ligaments as well as the sacrouterine ligaments along with an extensive sheet of bladder peritoneum were preserved on the graft side to enable stable fixation of the uterus in the recipient. Bilateral salpingectomy preserving the uterine branch of the utero-ovarian vein was done. The ureters were mobilized completely from the cervix and the uterus. Vagina was transected approximately 1.5 cm caudal to the vaginal fornix, and the uterus was attached to the donor by its 2 arterial and 2 venous vascular pedicles. The clamping points of the donor internal iliac vessels were closed with continuous proline 6-0 sutures, and abdomen was closed in standard 3-layered manner. For the graft preparation, the uterine graft was quickly brought to the back table and 10 ml heparinized saline injected in each artery, followed by cold HTK preservative solution for 10 to 20 minutes until the effluent was clear. The graft was kept on ice until the transplanted in the recipient. For the recipient surgery, The preparatory surgery of the recipient by the second team was already started in advance. Subumbilical midline incision was also given in the recipient. The vaginal vault was dissected free from the bladder and the rectum. The uterine rudiment was cleaved to reach up to the top of the vagina in the 8 cases of MRKH syndrome. Sutures 10 proline for subsequent organ fixation were attached to the round ligaments, the uterosacral ligaments, and the two lateralized parts of the uterine rudiments, or the paravaginal connective tissue in the cervical cancer patient. Preparation of the external iliac vessels for subsequent anastomosis was done. The external iliac artery and vein were bilaterally separated from each other and from the adjacent tissue to a distance of 6 cm. In terms of transplant, the uterine graft, which was brought on ice, was placed in the recipient's pelvis in the normal anatomical position. Bilateral end-to-side vascular anastomosis was performed between the graft vessels and the external iliac vessels with continuous 7-0 arterial anastomosis and 8-0 venous anastomosis. After each venous anastomosis, vascular clamp over the external iliac vein was opened. In 6 patients, the uterine branch of the ovarian uterine vein was anastomosed to the ipsilateral uterine vein or prepared for direct anastomosis to the external iliac vein. Mannitol 30 gram was given as an IV bolus just before removing the arterial clamps, and the systolic blood pressure was monitored and maintained at more than 100 millimeters of mercury. After completed vascular anastomosis, adequate blood flow through the uterine arteries of the vessels was verified and quantified using a vascular Doppler probe. In the recipient, vaginal vault was opened by a longitudinal incision of 4 cm. Vaginal rim of the graft was anastomosed to the top of the recipient's vagina with a continuous absorbable 2-0 suture. Uterus was fixed in its pelvic location by attaching the uterine ligaments to their pelvic counterparts with the previously placed fixation sutures, overlaying the extensive bladder peritoneum of the graft over the recipient's bladder fundus. This added to more stability of the graft. A Doppler probe with a silicon cuff was placed around one uterine artery to ascertain that the pulsatile blood flow was maintained during the initial 72-hour postoperative period, with the signal transduced through a thin cable through the midline incision. The cable with its crystal was then gently pulled out from its intra-abdominal position, leaving the silicon cuff in situ. Surgery and anesthesia of the recipients terminated identically in the donors. In terms of the immunosuppression and long-term medication, preoperatively, the recipients were given 1 gram of mycophenolate mofetil. During transplantation, just before reperfusion, the recipients received 500 milligrams of methylprednisolone and antithymocyte antibody, which was either thymoglobulin or antithymocyte globulin, which was repeated 12 hours later. The maintenance immunosuppressive therapy was continued with tacrolimus and mycophenolate mofetil twice daily. Oral glucocorticoids were administered once daily on the day of surgery and during the first 4 post-operative days. Antiviral prophylaxis was given with valganciclovir, depending upon the CMV status of the patient. In terms of follow-up, all the surgical complications were registered with the use of a Clavien Dindo classification. The clinical examination of the recipients was done twice weekly during the first month, once weekly during the second and the third month, and thereafter every other week. The uterus and the endometrium were examined with vaginal and abdominal two-dimensional ultrasonography. Color Doppler ultrasound was used to assess that blood flow was maintained through the uterine arteries. Clinical examination included visual inspection of the uterine cervix as well as the cervical cultures and biopsies. The biopsies were obtained at a predetermined time points, that is first week, second week and 4 weeks, and then monthly thereafter. Suspicion of any graft rejection was based on clinical examination, which included discolored cervix, abnormal vaginal discharge, enlarged uterus, fever or abdominal pain. The drug levels of tacrolimus or mycophenolate mofetil were monitored using standard assays. Routine blood tests were performed to assess liver and kidney functions and to detect infection. Rejection was based diagnosed on histopathological examination of cervical biopsies and graded according to the proposed rejection classification for the primate uterus. The results of this trial: the duration of the donor and recipient surgeries ranged from 10 to 13 hours and from 4 to 6 hours respectively. In the donor, post-operative stay was around 6 days, with one donor having grade 3B complication according to the Clavien Dindo due to uterovaginal fistula, for which re-implantation was done. No immediate perioperative complications occurred in any of the recipients. After 6 months, 7 uteri remained viable out of 9 with regular menses, which were started approximately 2 months after the transplant. Mild rejection episodes occurred in 4 of these patients. These rejection episodes were effectively reversed by corticosteroid boluses. 2 graft losses also occurred, which needed removal of the graft because of acute bilateral thrombotic uterine artery occlusions and persistent intrauterine infections. In the current scenario of robotics, the role of robotics was also explored by the same team of Brainstorm. They have recently published that robotic-assisted approach is advantageous in dissection in the deep pelvis, that in future a fully robotic approach for the uterine transplant may be also possible. Already, the Gothenburg 2 trial is an ongoing prospective observational study which started in 2016 at the same university hospital in Sweden for the uterine transplantation from live donor with robotic-assisted surgery. Also, the group from Iwazo has considered the possible role of Da Vinci robot in uterine transplant. They have come up with key steps for the robotic transplant as mentioned. Hence, uterine transplant is definitely a feasible option for the females and in turn definitely a boon for the womanhood and in turn the mankind. Thank you.